the thing that's so cool. If you give them full attention for a little bit, they get their cup full. They're good. And then you can say, Mom's got work to do, and when the timer goes off, I'll come get you. Or when the clock says the big hands on the 12, I'll come get you, and then we'll do something. So you don't have to be with your children all the time, is what I'm saying. If you give them some undivided attention, and they'll be good to engage themselves in activities right near you while you do what you need to do. And then you say, I'll come get you later. Now, if, on the other hand, you say this, you set it up, and you have this expectation, of course they're going to test you. And they're going to come over and go, Mom, is it okay if I'm using you?
Yeah.
Because you're in the front seat. You're just going to get used. Mom. And what you want to do when they do that, if you've set it up and you're now at the expectation stage, don't give any eye contact and do this. Because you've just told the child that I'm not available to you right now. I see you, I hear you, but I'm not going to engage with you right now because I'm doing this. Especially if you set that up in advance. If you choose to interrupt me while I'm on the phone or while I'm, you know, doing whatever I'm doing, this is what I'll do. And that means to tell you, I know you're here and I'll come get you later, but I'm doing what I'm doing. Even if you're reading the book, you get that time, Mom, Dad. You get to do that. You don't have to be available 24/7 to your children if you set it up. And if they have something they can do. And guess what? They're happy with a box. They are, aren't they? And actually, I like the word boring. The more bored they are, the more creative they're going to get with things they can do. You don't have to entertain them all the time. So it's about setting those expectations up. So slow down, set up those expectations, and hold them accountable. More conversation and less badgering. Again, remember I talked earlier about the language? They're interested in big words and conversations right now. Let's go out and find that leaf shape in our tree. Is there another tree like it? I wonder what the name of it is. Of course, you know the name. And you say, yeah, that's a aspen or whatever, because right now the leaves are coming out, aren't they? Let's go find out which leaves on the trees are out. I don't know at your house, but at my house, half of them are frozen. The aspens are fine, but some of the other ones are not those are good. Let's go find out which ones have green leaves on them yet, and which ones don't. Anything like that that has to do with you, purposeful movement, language, conversation, they love it, and it's where they are right now. You don't have to do that all day. 15 minutes, 10 minutes of that, and they're good. But allow that in their life. So having conversation and less badgering. The extent to which you're having to do reprimands, think about your language with your children, is the extent to which something is askew here, and you want to go back and think about what's going on that I'm having to always remind them, or I'm getting frustrated all the time. Question?
I'm just going backwards a little bit and thinking about the routine and like a picture schedule is very different than here's a sticker for yes, you got your shoes on kind of thing. So if we're working through here's our picture schedule, first we're gonna get up and make our bed and then this, and like even just putting a check mark on it, like a chalkboard checklist for the mornings. That's very different than...
Well, who's putting the check mark on, you or the child?
Well, the child would be.
Yeah. And did he help make the picture board?
If it existed, yes.
I'm sorry. I thought you said
the
that's what we do.
Exists.
Okay. Maybe he could draw the different pictures after you've had a discussion about, well, what do we do in the morning?
Yeah, okay.
What comes first? And you have the labels and he finds the pictures and you do a matching. Wouldn't that be cool? Make the bed. There's a little label and then he has a picture of a bed. Or however you do that, that would be fun for your 5.5-year-old. But you would take all Saturday and he'd have a blast making that. And then he checks it off. Absolutely. And some children really like visual reminders, which is great. It helps them figure out what comes next rather than you telling them. Some people like children like a list. Some children don't need anything. They got it. Just depends. So that's good. Especially your child's age, because he's going to now start being more responsible for his own time management as he moves into 6, 7, 15, 20. Good question. see
how
what
long
else.
Should a morning routine take as far as like trying to slow things down, but then like
getting out the door?
Yeah.
Depends on, first of all, it depends on your child, how fast they actually move and how fast you move. Some of us don't do well in the morning. And usually our temperament is already set when we're born, right? Don't you have one, maybe one child who's up, let's go, hey, it's all good, and the other child. So knowing who your children are and knowing who you are, start from when you have to leave and back up.
Right, so there's that, but then like there's, at some point, do we just acknowledge it's gonna take her like forever, or do we just try to like?
So give me an example. Is she not putting her shoes on? She's playing with her dolls
like,
or something?
I feel like all morning I'm like, we have to focus. We have to focus.
Okay.
Like we have to. What do we do next?
Okay.
Week?
Okay. And
like,
what is she? So what is she doing? Is she moving from
like,
thing to thing or?
How would you? I don't know. I feel like she's all over the place and she's.
How old?
She's three. And sometimes
okay.
She is like calling her and the negotiator. Like, no, we're not going on a bike ride right now. No, we're gonna. We need to get.
Oh, she wants to go on a bike ride in the morning.
She wants to do everything
okay. Okay.
Anymore.
Well, also she's having fun with language now, because she can use those words to relate to a thing.
She's never had a problem with language.
She understands that language relates to an object even when she was younger.
Oh,
okay.
Yeah.
Well,
like,
then
like she's got the language part.
Okay.
Down. Like,
so now she's negotiating.
Quite a while.
Some of that she's talking about, I wouldn't really respond to at all. Go back to what comes next. And again, maybe she needs, does she need a visual?
I feel like she's gotten a lot better.
So
like
is it developmental?
Take like 2 hours and it's me getting ready in 15 minutes and then it's trying to like herd.
Okay, so sometimes there's the, we're gonna go now and maybe it says that she's not dressed. Is that what happens?
I feel like the whole morning just takes forever.
Okay, so does she get dressed?
And none of it, so at least this one we don't know yet. But we are not morning people at all. Like, we are not. And she is not a morning person.
You need, maybe you do
either.
Need 2 hours. So everybody goes
yeah,
to bed
at
7.
It's more torturous, like, because we're all, and she, like, also, would she stay up as late as we'd let her, if we would. And she'd just sleep in, but that's not an option.
How does she
like,
do in the middle of the day?
As long as she gets a nap, she's good. Now, we try to get her to bed by 9, and other people, like, about die when we say 9, and she does need, like, that nap, but otherwise, like she's up and we're the same type in the morning.
So
like
what is it she's not doing?
Out.
I'm trying to find out.
What
is she
like
not
it's
doing?
So slow and I'm trying not to lose my mind at her.
Okay, so maybe are you upset or is it something she's not
well, sometimes
doing?
Sometimes I'm just like, I have to be to work or I
Okay, so there's a time
good.
When
yeah.
she when it's time to go.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's the default. It's gonna be time to go in 10 minutes.
But is it like realistic to expect a kid to get ready in an hour or like it
yes
we, like I'm just saying like how long
well
am I not being realistic in my expectations
an hour to get ready absolutely she can get
or
ready
or do I really need to adjust those expectations
she can get ready in an hour because it sounds to me like that's not been an expectation
I feel like it's an expectation but it's like a
dad's saying
it's just
no, I don't think it's been an expectation
okay.
You know what I would say is
here's
a good gauge personally how long would it take her to get ready to go for the bike ride?
Right. Yeah.
That tells
and
you
even,
how long it takes her to get ready.
Yeah.
Right?
Even
yeah.
then, though, like,
yeah,
she'll,
right.
I mean, like, it's just kind of like.
So she's, you, didn't you say she just turned 3?
Yeah.
I love here's a tip, parents. Now that you're 3,
mm-hmm.
now that you're 4, now that you're 10, now that you're 16, it's a great way to start having higher expectations. Now that you're 3, you will be expected to. Hold her accountable, and then if she's not ready, leave anyway. Take her with you, put the clothes in the bag, and go. What?
No, I don't know. Like, I feel, and I do feel like I drive mornings more, like, because I have a more hard, like, start at work,
yeah.
like, a lot of times. But yeah, there's a lot
that's
of
the reality of your family, and it's time to go. And it's she lives in your family, and it's time to go. You give her enough time in the morning, like Abby said, she could do it. Sounds to me like she's been getting given a lot of latitude. And now that you're 3, you can
yeah.
say things like that, now that you're 3, or now that you're going to school, or now that it's July, or you know, you just use something to anchor it. And rather than I need you to. See, then you get into this power struggle if it's because
yeah.
of you. And if she's feeling your stress that you need to go in the morning, that's something she can plan.
Like, I'm trying not to do it, but I know that I do it. Like,
well,
I know,
then
like,
she feels that. So that's where, see, that's where mom and dad, you have to be boring. Even if you've got to go and you're stressful, they can't feel that from you because they can play on it. Because what they want most of all, time with you and attention from you, and they'll get it any way they can. So even if you have to go and you're stressed about it, she can't feel that. You have to be bored. Make, have him do it. You look like you're pretty mellow. You go make breakfast. You deal with her.
He is more mellow.
See? That's why you have to have a partner. It helps so much. Good question, though. It's yeah, and it's about us too. Making
those times I'm just like, am I just being unrealistic in my expectation? Like,
no,
because I do wonder. I'm like,
Abby's right. How long would it take her to get dressed for the bike ride? Try it once.
Yeah,
try it on a Saturday. Yeah. We're gonna go on the bike ride. Let's go. How long? And then time it. That's how you know.
And then just like, I mean, in the morning, like, given the choice, I would rather sleep longer than do like so many things. And so I kind of assume a lot of times, like, when she's sleeping, that. She'd rather sleep than
you. Probably she would. Same for most of us. Yeah. Okay, another quick one is every possession should have a place. Mm-hmm. When we have so much stuff, it's everywhere. It's really hard to find what I have. It's also hard to get it put away. Remember I talked about beginning, middle, and end? To get it put away, it's a lot easier if there's a place for it. Is that handout there? Okay.
It's in the packet.
It's in the packet. There's a handout on less is more and putting things away. And you notice how things are on a shelf here? Look around. So the more you have a place for everything that they can see, and then let's say that you've got a toy here and a toy here and a toy here on a shelf, and then when they take this toy, they can see because there's a white space where it goes. When it's time to put it away. And then it's in some kind of a container that they can carry and it gets put away. If there's 27,000 things, they can't figure it out and they're still trying to figure out where this object ends and this object begins. It's really interesting about that. They're still, it's called sensory order, but basically they're figuring out what the qualities of every object are and they can't tell if it's in a big jumble. So that's why it's important to have everything having a place, and then you can hold, have them have the expectation to put it away. If you have a lot of stuff, we end up having, I think, a lot of books. Mm-hmm. Families have a lot of books, and we have high value on books. It's the same thing with a book. I would say if you've got some kind of a bookshelf that they stand up, and there's only so many books on the shelf as they can see, it's not that you're going to get rid of those books, it's you're going to cycle them in and out so that your child can choose. It's a lot easier to choose when there's fewer choices. And that's hard for all of us too, how many of us have too much stuff. And it's hard to find things when there's too many. And they're at this stage right now where they're working all that out, just figuring out where things are. Okay, anything else on here I want to talk about? See, keep staying in the present. Child isn't there yet, understanding later. If you're going on a vacation in a month, they don't understand that. The younger they are, the less they understand later. So keep it pretty simple. You're going to do something next year. Don't even talk about it. They don't get it. Tomorrow or the next day or the next day. Keep it pretty simple. The older they get, the more they can understand later. Planning your vacation, but at 2.5, 3, they're just not there yet. Keep it pretty simple and in the present. Okay, anything else? Did I talk about cell phones in your presence of your children? Here's what we're finding. I know we're all busy. We want to do multitasking. But children who have their parents are either on a device or on a cell phone, in their presence, the research, they feel hurt, jealous, and abandoned because your time is bifurcated and you're not present, and they're going to tell you the only way they can with their behaviors. And so put your phones away while you're with them, especially when you're coming to a transition. Get on the phone as soon as you pull away. But while you're with him, watch out for being on the phones. And it's really hard, I know, because we're busy. The phone rings and we feel like we have to answer it, or we have to answer one little email. If you do have to do anything like that, excuse yourself. Say, oh, I have to take this, I'll be right back. In other words, you're letting your child know that that's an anomaly, not the norm. And then you come back as soon as you can to being present with them, because sometimes you just have to take a call. But you don't want to have it be something normal. A question, yes, sir?
Yeah, this is organized sports can wait. I'm just trying to get a feel for how long.
My suggestion is that the idea of organized sports or organized activities is it's usually adult-decided, adult-driven, adult rules. And there's a time and a place for that, but for really young children, it's hard for them to figure out who I am when they're doing a lot of adult-directed activities.
So that's more for a three-year-old, maybe four-year-old?
What, adult? I mean,
no,
organized sport?
Organized sport.
I would say older than that.
Okay.
I mean, in other words, are you wanting like a toddler in soccer or something?
Maybe for swimming, at least.
Swimming lessons,
yeah.
That's different because that's a skill that I'm going to learn, is
right.
Swimming. I would do swimming lessons right away.
Right.
But anything like a team of some kind,
yeah,
that can wait. I mean, I know we want to do all that for our children. I get the soccer ball out and kick it around. Here's something else, speaking of that. What we're finding with professional baseball players is they can throw really far, and they can run fast, but they can't catch. Isn't that interesting? And it's because we haven't been playing catch. So get the ball out and play catch with your children. I find that fascinating. It's because we don't do that anymore. Everybody's going to these baseball camps and learning how to do these things, but catching is eye-hand coordination, and it's one-on-one. So, you know, kick the soccer ball around in the backyard and play catch. And hold off on those activities till later. Is that it?
Yeah.
Okay. Questions? Discussion? Concerns? Anybody scared? Is it hard to do this? Hard to separate from your child? Let me tell you, this is a wonderful Montessori school. I love this school. It gives me goosebumps. You've chosen so well with this school. Travel around all over and I see lots of Montessori schools. This is a good one. Kathy and Katie have been here a long time. And Abby and Josh created this beautiful space. You've made a really good choice being here. And I'm so happy for you. And I'm so happy for your children. I'm going to come and observe because it's so wonderful to be here. Can I go to school here, please? So all the best to you. And let's go do what we do. Thanks for coming this morning. I have some children's books up here that I brought for you to take a look at, and a couple of Montessori books for adults in case you're interested in learning more. I like, for young children, I really like those hard books, and keep it real simple and reality-oriented. There's time for all that other stuff later, so go ahead and take a look if you want on some of those books, and I can stick around if you want to chat about anything else. Thank you very much. Abby, do you want to say anything before we say goodbye? You sure? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.